It's a pleasure and an honor for me to be with all of you. On January 24, my manager was shot in the back of his head in Puerto Princesa. And what's happened after that has been an extremely educational experience for me, but also very painful. And what I'd like to do today is to be able to share with you what I have uncovered and discovered, and in the hope of maybe something of continuing the momentum we have started for something really productive for our country. So from what I've learned in the past month, is that we have a planet, and for that planet to survive, it needs biodiversity. Biodiversity is life. It gives us food, it gives us water, it gives us air. The different variety of flora and fauna is absolutely essential for our ecology to be robust. You know how if you have cousins and you marry your cousins and your cousins marry your cousins, then the children are not going to come out so big and strong and healthy. So in the same way, if we have different variety of flora and fauna and plants and animals and all these things, it makes our ecology very, very healthy. It's like the immune system of our economy. It is life. Now, 70% of the biodiversity of the planet is found in 17 countries. We call them mega diversity countries. They're absolutely amazing because they have all this biodiversity there. And the Philippines is most blessed to be one of those 17 mega diversity countries. We have in our we run together with Brazil, with China, with Madagascar. However, among all those 17 biodiversity countries, we are number one in terms of endemicity. What is endemicity? Endemicity is creatures and plants that are found only in the Philippines. It cannot be found anywhere else. It can be found only here. And in terms of endemicity, we are actually number one. In terms of biodiversity hotspots, which means biodiversity which is threatened, we're also number one. So Madagascar is three times bigger than the Philippines. However, Madagascar has 105 species. We have 180. Madagascar has 80 endemic species. We have 115. Over here, it says more species are being discovered. The Philippines has one of the highest discovery rates in the world. This is what makes us special. This is what God has given us. We have the highest rate of endemicity per unit area. This is our blessing. Okay, we have the Philippine eagle. We have the tamarau. We have the cockatoo and so many others. All right, this was the Philippines in the 1500s. Lush, full, gorgeously beautiful. 400 years later, it took 400 years to go down to 70%. By the 1950s, we were down to half. By the 1970s, we were down to 34%. By the year 2000, we are at this state. So sad, so sad, so sad. You know, the conservationist, Dr. Aldrin, was with me in one talk, and he was saying, you know, I don't know about consultations and things like this. I'm a scientist. And he says, I know that there is a tipping point. There's a tipping point. And the question is, what route do we want to go? Do we want to go the route of Cebu? Because Cebu has 7% forest cover left, and they have severe water shortages. They are importing their water. Bacolod has 4% forest cover left, and they are also have, and they also have severe water shortages. 10%. 10% is a tipping point. When you hit 10%, the water shortages come, and then the species steadily begin to disintegrate, and they never, never come back. So the question is, do we want to go that route? Right now, the Philippines is at 18.3. And our old growth forest means it's a forest which was made by God. It has come because of the needs of the ecosystem. Man didn't plant these trees. The ecosystem planted these trees. And that's why the law says you should not denude old growth forests, because if you denude the old growth forest, then you're setting a domino effect in the ecological system, which is negative because it's supplying a need. If you take it out, then what will happen to that need? That need goes unfulfilled. Old growth forests should never be denuded. And right now, our old growth forest is at a staggering 3%. Very, very sad. All right. Aldrin also told me one thing. He said that if you look at Brazil, it will take Brazil 100 years to finish off its forest. It's so amazingly lush. At the rate the Philippines is going, it's going to take us 5 more years. And I want to applaud Noynoy for doing a commercial log ban and saying there's no more deforestation in the country. But you can't give a commercial log ban and allow mining at the same time. It's schizophrenic. So the question is Palawan. Why Palawan? Because Palawan has we needed a rallying cry. And Palawan has 17 key biodiversity area, which means 17, which is part of that 70% which is needed for the planet to survive. We, with the highest endemicity, what we do is we actually contribute to what is known as the global common. The global common is this, you know, you have the planet, and then there's this space there which is needed for the planet to survive. It's called the global common. We are a key contributor to the global common. Now, Palawan has 17 key biodiversity areas, which is part of the 70%. On top of that, it has 2 World Heritage sites. On top of that, it has 8 declared protected sites. May I ask the audience, who here has been to Palawan? Oh, I mean, good company, no? Good, good, good. All right, so you know how gorgeously beautiful it is. Now, Palawan, it's a very thin sliver of an island. And actually, if you look at it from a Google map, you will see that it's actually also very rich in minerals. You know, it's rich in minerals, but it has also other assets. Now, the question is, where do we go? Where do we go? Now, can you see it's very thin? And this is what the scientists say. Although seemingly lush and bountiful, the environment of Palawan is fragile, and its topsoil is relatively thin. This is what the scientists say. All right, if you look at that, that's a mining operation. It's Rio Tuba mining operation. It's been there for 30 years. Now that's the Batarasa, more than 30 years. And now they've extracted all they could here, and now they're inching towards Mount Bulanao. They have an application for 800 hectares of this very sacred protected area. And if you see here, the topography of Palawan is very steep. It's very steep. So if you take away the trees, and the trees are holding the soil, you know when you dig and you get the minerals out of the country, and then you leave what's known as tailings. And if it rains, those tailings, because it's very steep, go direct to the coral reefs. And then if you cut the trees, another friend said that if you take away the trees, these species don't swim. So where will they go? They'll have no place to go. They'll just die. So this was Palawan in 1978. 61,000. You know, the other, I think it must have been about 10 days ago or something, PCSD came up with a big ad. And they, you know, because I've been faulting PCSD. Okay, let me give you another backgrounder. Palawan has a law called the Palawan Law, which is unique. And it is not seen anywhere else in the world. It's a law which actually gives the provincial government precedence over the national government. DNR cannot do anything in Palawan unless the provincial government allows. And the law was conceived of precisely to protect Palawan. And this is an amazing, this is a very clear manifestation of a law which is beautiful in concept and then becomes bastardized when it is implemented by opportunists, which is exactly what happened in Palawan. Okay, because what happened? Palawan in 1978 looked like this. By 1993, it looked like this. And by 2000, it was steadily diminishing. And the PCSD rebutted, and they said, oh, you know, you're fighting against no mining in Palawan, but Palawan still has huge forest cover. And I was saying, my God, they just don't get it. No, precisely, it still has forest cover left, like no other in the Philippines. Precisely, that's what it's all about. And the reason for its having big forest cover is not the reason to mutilate it. It's what we have left. Okay, so that's 1987. And then that's 2001. And if you can see it, that's from a Google map, it really looks like a boil, which is spreading. And it looks like cancer. All right, Palawan has amazing biodiversity. It has 81 species of the known seagrass. It has 90 species of mangroves, 44,500 hectares of mangrove. It has 379 species of corals, 89 species of total reef fish, so on and so forth. 4 of the 5 marine turtles, 50% of the freshwater fish, 25% of the amphibians. Amazing biodiversity. This is all data from Conservation International. And there are many laws that protect Palawan. Palawan is known in 1967 because it was so special. There is a law that said it's a game refuge and wildlife sanctuary. There was another law that made it a mangrove reserve. And then it was UNESCO even said that it's a man and biosphere reserve. There's a NIPAS law, Republic Act 7611, so on and so forth. So many laws. And one wonders, in the sphere of all these laws, why is all of this happening? What is PCSD doing? If they are doing their job, then why aren't the laws being followed? Why is Palawan being made to endure this? Okay, if you look at Palawan, it's a very thin sliver. And then if you look at all of that, those are mining applications. Mining applications in this very thin sliver of an island. And there's even a mining application in the underground river. And the Chamber of Mines was saying, that's preposterous. Yeah, but it's true. There's a mining application. I think it's Canadian, Jerthy. There's a mining application even in the underground river. In the place where Jerry was born, you know, I went there during the funeral. There are 79 mining applications. All right, if you look at this, these are all the areas of the... This was mapped by Conservation International. These are the biodiversity sites in Palawan. And you know what this is? Those are mining applications, 354 mining applications in the very same place as the biodiversity sites. The reason why we need to make a stand here is because this is the era of global warming and climate change. And now, I mean, I feel more cold when I wake up in the morning. That's because the ice caps are melting in the North Pole. And that's zillions of miles away. And if what's happening in the North Pole is affecting me here in Manila, do we really think we could ravage a part of our country and the rest of our country will not get affected? Do we really think we can ravage a part of an island and the rest of the island will be intact? Okay, what happens? What happens when you mine? This has been a very painful experience for me to see what happens when you mine. Okay, do you see this? That's a truck. So if that's a truck, what is that? I mean, can you imagine the hugeness? And that's happening in Palawan? Okay, what happens when you mine? You dig a hole in the ground, and then you get the minerals, because the minerals are under. And then you bring it out of the country. You know, the minerals don't even stay in our country. They're brought out of the country. And tailings are left there. You know, the residue minerals are called tailings. And then when it rains, the water mixes with the tailings and then pollutes the water supply. Okay, this is in an abandoned and unrehabilitated copper mine. Okay, this is a mining apparatus near the water in Palawan. That's a mining operation near the water. This is an abandoned mine, and of course this body of water is toxic.